Sorry for delay of for 10 to 15 minutes. Doing this particular session live because we wanted to talk about the IUI, and the IUI has been a neglected treatment in the ART field. All of us are knowing in 2013 there is a nice guideline which has come up saying that they offered that the IUI is no longer been the treatment of a choice, what they quote, because what they found out is like IUI. When you are talking about the IUI, the indications for IUI, all of us are knowing that there are the two indications of IUI. Is the first is a male factor infertility, then unexplained infertility, or maybe a mild endometriosis. In 2013, the NICE guidelines, they clearly mentioned that there was no need of doing a IUI for that matter. And they purposefully talked about it because they want, like, the patient should have waited for 2 years in relation to the endometriosis or a mild factor, male mild factor infertility. But this all is based upon the method which is a mathematically modeling, and it is all which is not depending upon the prospective randomized trial. So the NICE, when they come up with the guideline, they talked about there is no recommendation of the IUI. Why? Because there is all the things are depending upon the observational studies and the peer-reviewed published articles. They are not taken into account about the proper randomized control trial. It is not based upon anything which is RCTs are being made out. So they talked about the IUI is not more recommended, is only been a published peer reviewed article. So these are the first, my session will be, I'll be writing it down so that all of you should know what we are talking about today. So the first thing I will be covering little bit about why IUI is important. I talk to you because there is a controversy about the NICE guidelines, and that's why we are not following the NICE guideline, because it is not been that much taken into account, because it's not depending upon the RCTs or maybe a prospective randomized trial. It is only based upon the published peer review article. So in a developed countries like India, where I belong to, or where we are, all of us are practicing, IUI is one of the method for practice. So any one of you have the questions for my, so you can write it up so that I can communicate with all of you. So we are coming out now, this my particular talk of IUI will be dealing with, first is a history, then secondly, why IUI to be done, in which condition it has to be done. Secondly, whether it will really make a difference when you are talking about certain indications of doing a IUI. Thirdly, I will be talking about semen parameters, what actually semen parameters one should be taken into account, and why it makes a difference to all of us. And singularly, what is the volume of a semen, what you call as post-wash volume of IUI should be taken into account. Secondly, whether it is a double IUI or a single time IUI, which is important. And whether we should give a trigger, we should be doing a natural IUI, or one should be, what is the success rate when you are talking about a gonadotropin IUI cycles. And the steps to improve, what is the patient selection criteria, why particularly. Hi Nilam, thank you for watching me. Hi Vikram. So we'll be talking about steps to improve the IUI success rates. So coming down to the history, something is like, who invented what you call as a spermatozoa? See, like the 100 decades ago in 16th century, 1678, the spermatozoa was invented by Antony. So this is not something new, but it takes 100 years. Mind by word, it takes 100 years from 16th century to 17th century, the first IUI is been done. So 100 years, when they found out the sperm is an existing entity, And the first IUI to be documented, it takes 100 years. So Nitin, which stimulation protocol is good and outcome? Yeah, that I will be talking about, and the AMH of the patients also. So this talk will be like, I think my today I'll be able to talk half an hour, that maximum I can talk continuously. So in this half an hour will be maximum I will be dealing with the answering your questions. So coming down to the history part, from 16th century they come up to the 17th century, that is 1770, the John Hunter, he done a first IUI, that to be a vaginal IUI, intravaginal insemination of a semen sample, and they documented it is for the patient of a severe hypospadiasis. So the hypospadiasis patient, they done a first IUI in order to make the semen preparation, and they had put that semen preparation intravaginally, and after that maybe of 5 to 6 years they documented some around 55 IUI, intravaginal IUI, out of which only they had a successful pregnancies of 4. In 1953, like see like how the history evolved. History started of an invention of an entity of a spermatozoa in 16th century. In 17th century they done a intravaginal IUI, and in 19th century they done a first IUI with the frozen semen sample. So the frozen technology for IUI, it takes another 2 decades, from 17th century to coming down to the 19th century. So whenever we are doing a frozen cycle or a frozen cycle IUI, for that matter a semen samples which has been frozen, and then it is IUI been documented and successful pregnancy, it takes 200 years. So this is the history part of it. So just to understand why the people they thought of a IUI to be done. See, first of all of us are knowing that a routine normal intercourse, it takes like if a 14 million count is there, which is reposited into the vagina, out of one sperm will be there in the fallopian tube. So the concept of a IUI come down to in a way that if we are putting a more semen parameters or good healthy sperm inside the uterine cavity, will make a more gametes available for interaction and then to be a fertilization. All of us are knowing the normal semen, it contains leukocytes, it contains prostaglandins, it contains a dead sperm, and also it contains a decapacitating factors. Why decapacitating factor is there? Because we want capacitation has to occur, and that has to be occur in the reproductive tract in order to interact with the oocyte, and that's the main stage of a IUI. When you are putting the semen sample without a preparation, we all know there is a leukocytes, there are the decapacitating factors which will not going to increase our success rate. So in order to have the success rate, we need to prepare the semen sample, and we need to have a good semen sample to be processed, and this processed sample has to be injected into the uterine cavity in order to have a good IUI success rate. Then coming down to the basic indications of IUI, the IUI usually been done with all of us are knowing the semen factors. The semen factors is very volatile. If you go to the WHO manuals in 2010 and recently released a WHO manual in 2013, you feel there is a lot of a difference in a semen parameters, what they call as a normal semen parameters. Similarly, when you are talking about a mild factor or male factor responsible for IUI, all of us are known there is called as a male factor, but when you called as a mild, when you called as moderate, when you called as a severe male factor which is responsible, because all of us are now talking about IUI. So IUI should be done in a mild factor or a male mild factor infertility. Secondly, I'll come down to that in a little while. Then coming down to unexplained, when you called as a unexplained, when all the factors, all you evaluated male factors, female factor for that matter, all the things are been evaluated, and then there is nothing which is been documented, we called as unexplained infertility. So in which patients you likely to do a IUI when you stamp the patient as a unexplained infertility. So the first of all, you must know there is called as a one thing is called as a scoring system. We have a Hunold score system. I'll draw for all of you what is Hunold score. See, one must know which patients to be selected, and one must know in which patient will getting a good results. So this is the scoring system that is called as Hunold scoring system. And this Hunold scoring system, there is a percentage. If the percentage is too bad, we not taking those patients for IUI, we are going to take those patients for directly for IVF, or for that matter, if the patient is not affording, we'll be giving a two chances of a IUI, maybe a gonadotropin stimulation IUI for that matter. If a Hunold score is more than 30, there is a patients of unexplained infertility, you have to wait for 12 months. See, mind well, you must understand the scoring system when you are putting the patient for particular patients for IUI cycles. This is a beautiful scoring system which will tell us whether the infertility patient has to wait for a spontaneous pregnancy to achieve, whether the patient should be going for a natural cycle IUI, whether the patient should be going for ovulation stimulation and IUI, or whether the patient directly should be referred to for IVF. So this Hunold scoring system, in 5 minutes I will draw for you, or maybe I will zoom the image and I will tell you what it is. If the scores is more than 30%, it means that she has her own capacity to conceive in a 1 year span. And if you do a IUI, which is not going to helpful for those couple. So if the scores are more than 30%, it is better to wait for 1 year rather than attempting IUI. And if they are not conceived in 1 year, I'm talking about unexplained infertility. So mind well, if the patient is unexplained infertility, you done the score. If the scoring is more than 30%, you wait for 1 year. If she is not conceived, you have to try for IUI after 6 months of a treatment. Then coming down to the mild factor male infertility. Just now I talked to you about different things of a IUI and male factor. See, who is doing the semen analysis, that matters. Whether you are doing a semen analysis in a Nubas chambers, or whether it is a really integrated automated machine of doing a semen analysis, or if you are doing a semen analysis under the chamber. So that is most important thing when you're talking about a semen analysis. But then you must ask me, what is the mild, what is the moderate, and what is the severe, in which patient I should not attempt the IUI. There is a beautiful guidelines. When the patient is having a 10 million, there is a two things. One is a pre-wash, another is a post-wash. So the pre-wash, what I mean by the pre-wash, where you have a sample which is not been processed, which is coming down to you, and you have just done a analysis of the semen parameters. If the analysis of the semen parameters tell you if it is a 10 million count or more than that, those are the patients where you call as a mild male factor infertility. And if you are doing a IUI in those patients, the chances of success will be a higher one. And in a reverse way, if you have just taken a NIDA sample of a semen sample, and if you have seen what is the motility or what is the count, and if it is a 3 million count, so it means that the patient is having a severe male factor infertility. So if those particular things are taken into account, you must know which patients to be taken into account for IUI and which patient should not be addressed. Depending upon, first I told you about the scoring system, that is Hunold scoring system. Secondly, I told you about the male factor, whether it is a mild factor or whether it is a severe factor, just to take a semen analysis report, and whether it is a 10 million good total motility count. So 10 million is not, I'm talking about a total count. It is a total motile sperm count, TMSC, total motile sperm count. If it is a 10 million and more in a NIDA sample, which will give us a good results in IUI. If it is a less than 3 million, which will give us a not that much good results. So coming down to the another factor or another indications for IUI, is the second is a mild endometriosis. All of us are knowing that what is the mild endometriosis. When you put in the scope inside the abdomen, all of us are looking for the endometriotic lesions. Endometriotic lesions is usually seen in a ovarian fossa, maybe uterosacral ligaments, maybe in the pouch of Douglas, maybe a bladder or anywhere else. There is a revised American fertility scoring system which will tell us the scores about the endometriosis. If the endometriosis is mild, it is better that the patient should go a IUI treatment rather than putting the patient for expectant management of a treatment for a longer duration. If she is a case of a severe endometriosis, it is better that one should not be doing a IUI. In those patients, IVF plays an important role. So coming down to the another thing is a semen. After this, we'll be talking about like there was a question from stimulation protocols that was asked by which stimulation protocols and how it's to be done. So coming down to that particular things, first of all, mind you well, there is a different school of thoughts in overall the world. We have a natural cycle IUI, we have ovulation stimulated cycle IUI, and we have another thing is a multifollicular development and IUI, that is called as a COH IUI. All of us are knowing about it. The IUI has its particular role to play. When you are talking about single follicular development IUI with the letrozole or for that matter a clomiphene citrate, the single follicle doing a IUI which will gives us a percentage success rate is of 5%. If you increase from one follicle to two follicles, then the success rate from 5% it will increase to the 8%. And when it is from one to two follicles, it becomes a three follicles, the success rate is increased to the 10%. So your aim when you are talking about stimulation protocols in IUI, first you need to decide about what is the age of the patient, what is the AMH of the patient, what is the AFC or anterior follicle count, and then depending upon all these factors, you need to think wisely choosing of a drug. If you are choosing the drug like a clomiphene citrate, all of us are knowing that the clomiphene citrate has a negative impact on the endometrium, so you should not be bothering about a negative impact on the endometrium or endometrial thickness. When you are talking about endometrial thickness, it should not be hampering you the IUI success rate. Endometrial thickness has no role as far as the IUI cycles are concerned. They had documented that there are many literatures which will tell you even if there is a no good endometrial thickness, the IUI success rate doesn't increase or decrease for that matter. When you are talking about some drugs to be get stimulated like a clomiphene citrate, you started 100 milligram of clomiphene citrate maybe on day 3 or day 4 or maybe day 5 of a cycle, and if you keep on doing the folliculometry and you are not thinking that the endometrium is not good, it is better to do a IUI because that particular drug has an anti-estrogenic effect on the endometrium, and that's why endometrium is not growing, and that not going to hamper your success rate. So when you are talking about stimulation, thinking which drug you are using and in which capacity you are using. So this is the first thing in ovulation induction in IUI. The first is the age of the patient. If she is more than 42 years, there is no point in doing a IUI in those patients because there is a ovarian diminishedness is already been there, and secondly, you're not knowing the quality of the oocyte. Mind well, friends, when I'm talking about on this particular platform, which is global platform, I should be talking which is a scientific based. If you are doing a stimulation in IUI cycles where the age of the patient is more than 40, so in those particular patients, you will not, even if there is ovulated, you not knowing what is the quality of the oocyte. All of us are knowing when we are doing a IUI or for that matter IVF, we take the oocyte, we know the quality of the oocyte. So as the age advances, the quality of the oocyte drops down. So there is a little bit a role of a IUI when the patient is 40 years or more. When the patient is young, like maybe a 29 years or maybe a 35 years, the chances of a success in IUI is much more higher, because we all of us are known the AFC on in those patients are good. We get the good stimulations with the little dose of a letrozole or maybe a clomiphene citrate. If you are categorized the patients into different normogonadotropic, normogonadism, or maybe hypogonadotropic, or maybe a PCOS patients, in those patients, the first line of stimulation is a letrozole as far as the PCOS patients are considered. But till today, if you go through the all literatures like ISHRAE or maybe ASRM, the first line of a drug for stimulation is clomiphene citrate. You can start the clomiphene citrate is 100 milligram, or maybe depending upon the previous response. You need to take some time in seeing what is the previous response the patient is having. If you are giving a 50 milligram of clomiphene citrate and she is not ovulated or she has not shown the good response, then it is a time to increase the dose. So you can start with 100 milligram of clomiphene citrate and see with the follicular study how the follicles are behaving. Because see, if you increase the one follicle, your chances of a IUI is getting the pregnancy is from 5% to 8%. But if you go on increasing the follicle, it will not increase the pregnancy rate. Even after the follicle 3, the pregnancy rate will be at 10% only. So don't think of giving a gonadotropin to the dose that if you are going to have multiple follicles more than 4 or more than 8, which will increase your chances of success in IUI. I'm talking about only IUI. I'm not talking here about IVF or maybe converting IUI cycle into IVF cycle. What today I was talking about is just to do a basic follicular study. And if you're thinking of one follicle will give me 5% pregnancy rate, I'm talking about pregnancy rate. I'm not talking about anything a clinical pregnancy rate. A 5%. If you are going to do some ovulation stimulation where you are going to have a prayer for two follicles or maybe a three follicles, the chances of IUI is goes to the 10%. So in order to why we are thinking of this, why I'm talking about number of follicles, why I'm talking about which drugs to be given, because a single follicle increment will be there is a chance of OHSS and chance of a multi fetal pregnancy. See, now the era is evolved. We are evolved in ART practice. We are evolved even in endoscopy. What is important is to have a safe pregnancy, singleton pregnancy, and a pregnancy which will give us a 9 months, 9 days baby. So if you are thinking of too much of stimulation, that will go into eventually into OHSS or maybe IUI cycle cancellation. And even if she become pregnant, the chances of a multifetal pregnancy is much more higher. I'll be going into that detail, what is the cost effectiveness of IUI cycles. Secondly, if she become pregnant, the chances of NICU admissions are much more, chances of premature deliveries is much more, chances of IUGR babies are much more. So that is the relative risk when you are doing such a things which is called as a multifollicular development, for that matter IUI is considered. So it is better, and if you go recent advances in ISHRAE also, if it is a follicle which is more than two follicles, which is more than 15 millimeters, it is better not to go for IUI. If a 10 millimeter follicles is more than 3, then it is better not to go for IUI, because a chances of multifetal pregnancy, chances of OHSS is much more higher, and that is a ISHRAE guidelines. So when you are talking something is a guidelines, they are researched and they are published. So even if someone is doing IUI in 5 follicles and not getting anything what you called as adverse effect or OHSS, that doesn't mean that is the standard practice. What is the standard practice protocol? You need to have a 3 follicles maximum, or maybe a 1 dominant follicle, and then do IUI. Even if you have a more follicles and you do a gonadotropin stimulation, the chances of IUI is not going to increase. The pregnancy rate is not going to increase more than 10%. So what you will achieve just giving a gonadotropins or just making a OHSS? You are not going to achieve the pregnancy rate. So mind well, when you are doing a stimulation protocol, it is always better to give a drug which will give you a monofollicular development like a letrozole or maybe a clomiphene citrate,
where the folliculometry plays the important role, and the folliculometry has to be done from day 7 onwards. And if you think that there is a more than 10 millimeter follicle and the size is more than 10 millimeter and there are 5 follicles, it is better to abandon the IUI cycles, because that will not going to give me a much more pregnancy rate, that will hamper my success rate. Then coming down to, there is called as a ProRail trial. The ProRail trial, which is been documented and which is now now come up with the higher things. What I mean by the higher in that particular regard is like which media you used for semen type. I will be coming to that again, and any role of adjuvant drugs in ovulation induction. Vikram, I will be talking to that also, adjuvants in IUI, whether which adjuvants to be given. For particularly when I was talking about selection of the patient. So coming down to that particular, I likely to show you what is a Hunol scoring system. In just a minute, I'll just with the other phone, I'll increase the image, and if it is like, I can show it to you what exactly I mean by it, because I cannot draw. That is a scoring system for infertility. So just a minute, give me a time minute so that I can focus on the phone and tell you. Yes, so this is, I think it's not clear. Yeah, this is a scoring system. If you go through the scoring, there is called as woman's age, then there is a duration of a subfertility, whether it is a type of fertility, whether it is primary or secondary, and the sperm progressive motility, and again whether it is a referral status. If you go through all the scoring system, I think it's not clear. Yeah, so if you go through the scoring system, you will calculate the scores of it, and what I was talking about is a 30% and 40%. I'll just show you the another slide of it. Just a minute. No, another. The first one. No. Yeah. The last paragraph. No, this one. Yeah. Okay. So this, I think, we have taken into the like proper things. Okay, see, this is the predictive 1 year live birth. When you are choosing the patients for IUI, this is a beautiful what they quote. This is a prognostic index score, and this is the index when there is a, if it is more than 40%, you see hardly anyone is there is likely a chance that anyone is going to have a spontaneous or IUI pregnancy rates. If it is less than 30, the chances of IUI is going to work is much more higher. So if you have that particular scoring system, I think this is the scoring system, and this particular scoring system, and if you are really known for this particular and you used to this particular scoring system, you know which patient is going to get pregnancy and which patients you will not going to have the pregnancies. So I was coming down to this particular selection of the patient. After the selection of the patient, we'll be talking about is something called as a semen preparation, and what at least what there was a question, what media we are using and what is the semen sample procedures. See, if you go through the all literatures and guidelines, IUI can be prepared with this only by three methods: simple dilution, second method is by swim up, and third is a density gradient. Till 2012 or maybe a 2007 Cochrane review, if you go through the Cochrane research and all that thing, till 2007 you research all the articles about the preparation of the semen sample, any role of cervical mucus. Okay, I'll come down to that also. I'll send Shobha, I will send I'll post this particular table on my this group also, so that all of you can really go through this particular table and you know properly how to do the scoring system. So coming down to the literature, what literature says about the preparation of the semen sample, whether we should go with the simple dilution, whether we should go with the what you call as a swim up technique or we should go with the density gradient. See, till 2007 there are the RCTs or maybe a Cochrane review. They clearly state that there is no better method of using any semen preparation methods. But recently in 2014 there is a beautiful RCT which come up that density gradient method is a much more acceptable method of making a semen preparation for IUI, and maybe in 2 days span we'll be teaching you about a different swim up techniques, how we do it in our center and what is nationally or internationally the people do. So whenever you are doing with the semen preparation, the mind well, the collection time, the when the semen is collected in a wild mouth jar which is given to the patient, it has to be named properly, and the timing to be put up when the sample is received in the lab. Why it is important? Because once the sample is received into the lab, and the time of insemination is important, because if it is between 40 to 80 minutes, if it is more than that, there is no point in doing a IUI for that patient. If the semen prepared and it is kept, even if it is kept in an incubator, or even if it is transported from one clinic to another clinic, and if it is more than 60 minutes, there is no point in doing the IUI, because your IUI success is going to go down drastically. Coming down to the timing of the IUI then, and the semen parameters. Let me coming down to the semen parameters, because there is a lot of questions that come up with the semen parameters and what. The semen parameters, first of all, is a mild factor. What you I just talked about, a total motile sperm count. There is a one question, just I'll read that question. Okay, the Amit Kumari just asked one question, I just reading it. Okay. Amit, I'll come back to you regarding this. Let me finish about the semen parameters and all that things. See, there is a heterogeneity in the semen parameters. There is a difference in nation, because there are my friends, my colleagues who are watching from USA, UK, Istanbul and all Arab countries. For them also the semen parameters differs, the range differs. For Asian population like us, the range of the semen parameters differs. So where there is nothing consensus about the semen parameters, where you called as a severe male factor infertility, or those patients required a treatment, even if there is a documented patients of a 2 million sperm count conceived spontaneously. So you never stamped that as severe male factor infertility or male factor infertility. But for that matter, when you're talking about a IUI, we definitely know there is a total motile sperm count. If the total motile sperm count is more than 10 million, it means that the patient is having a mild male factor infertility. If it is less than a 3 million, it means that the patient should be addressed for an IVF. That I very much clearly told all of you. When you are doing a preparation, like I told you prior, there is no difference till 2007 and for preparation of an IUI sample. Now all of us are doing a density gradient for semen preparation. And once you, what is the make a difference? Because if you are doing a semen preparation by density gradient, you need to know what is the NIDA sample. What is the count in a NIDA sample and what is the count post-wash. If the post-wash count is more than 10 million, total motile count is more than the 10 million, the chances of success of a IUI is much more. If you are having the count, post-wash count, suppose you have 5 million, and she is having, again the male factor is the issue, and she is a post-wash count, that particular male factor infertility is 5 million, then you need to think about what is the morphology of the patient. Because at least for IUI, to get a successful IUI done, you need to have a 4% normal morphology, even if it is a severe or if it is a deranged male factor infertility. So up till now, if I'm very much clear to all of you, if there is a male factor or a mild factor infertility, the chances of IUI is going to be a, get a higher when there is a 10 million count post wash to a total motile count. When I'm talking about count, is a total motile count. And if it is less than 5 million or 3 million, then morphology plays a plays important factor, and morphology has to be documented when you are giving a semen parameter report. If it is a semen parameters which is less than 4% normal morphology, it is better not to consider IUI, because we are not getting a good results or a successful pregnancies. Then there was a questions about patient has a oligoastenospermia and sperm DNA integrated assessment. I'll be coming to that also, Vikram, because only when there is a severe factor, male factor infertility. Suppose he is having a 3 million count, then your sperm degradation factor, that is called as a DNA fragmentation. If the DNA fragmentation is a 12% or more than that, those particular semen is not a good semen as far as the IUI is considered. Is if the DNA fragmentation is much more, or fragmentation index is much more, it is better to do a ICSI in those patients. So it is very well known, if it is, even if it is an oligoastenospermia, it depends upon what sperm parameters you are looking for. And if it is a, first of all, I talk to you selection in the, it comes to the male also. If the male age is on a higher side, I'm talking very this thing again, if the male age is on a higher side, it affects only the volume motility, volume motility, but not usually affects the morphology. But so the advanced age is only the parameters of when you're talking about the motility, but not about the morphology. But if you're talking about the DNA fragmentation index, if it is more than 12% and age is advanced, then it is better to refer the patient for the ICSI rather than just to do a IUI, because IUI will not going to have a live birth rate or the pregnancies. Same thing when the patient is coming down to you with a 10 million count or lesser than that, then the morphology plays the role. If it is 10 million and more, then it is usually a good sample to do a IUI. The IUI should be done within the 40 to 60 minutes of a prepared semen sample. Okay, so I think I'll be very clear about that. There was the one question that the patient is a polycystic ovaries and having the AMH is of 3.2. What actually to be done? See, the AMH is of 3.2. Even if you don't say it is a PCOS, nowadays we all of us know AMH on the higher side is usually a PCO patient. So in those patients, I think it is better to give a letrozole, because letrozole is a drug which will give us a monofollicular development and doesn't have any effect on the endometrium like that of the clomiphene citrate. The clomiphene citrate usually gives the thin endometrium multifollicular development. So we don't want those things to happen in the PCOS. So in the PCOS with the AMH of 3.2, it is better to give a letrozole. Even if a letrozole with the 2.5 you can start with the 2.5 twice a day and see for the response of the follicular study. Secondly, then they're coming down to the my topic of today's discussion about the semen which is coming down to you. You prepared the semen sample. What is the timing? Whether you will give single insemination or it should be a two-time insemination, or what exactly the timing of the after you done some called as a stimulated cycle IUI. If you are doing a stimulated cycle IUI, like if you are using clomiphene citrate or for that matter letrozole, and if you wish to give a trigger, there is no difference if you are talking about urinary SCG, you are talking about recombinant SCG. As far as the IUI results are considered, there is no difference in the pregnancy rates or live birth rate. And so if you are using a 5000 international units of urinary SCG is the same as that of the 250 of a recombinant SCG, or if you are really thinking of giving a gonadotropin and agonist trigger, it will not change your pregnancy rate. So the trigger doesn't make any sense if you are using a urinary product, if you are using a recombinant HCG or something like that. So coming down to the, after you've given a natural cycle, what about the natural cycle IUI? There is a beautiful studies in 2017 which will definitely tell you, if you're doing a natural cycle IUI, it has to be monitored with the LH surge. What I mean by the LH surge, all of us are in India, we know that there is a kit, LH kit. It comes in a different name. So you just do a urinary kit of LH surge, and which will tell you, is there is a LH surge, it is better to do a IUI after 1 day. So IUI, the timing of the IUI is 1 day after the natural cycle LH surge. That is definitely there. If you are doing a stimulated cycle and if you wish to do a trigger, in those patients you have to really think whether you are going to do a two times IUI or whether you are going to do a single time IUI. If it is a single time IUI or maybe a double time IUI, I'll go into the details of it, but it has to be done between any period of time between 24 hours to 40 hours. The chances of pregnancy remains the same. It remains the same. So you not worry, like if you given the trigger and next day is a holiday, what you will do? So within the 40 hours, you can do any period of time IUI. So this is regarding your single or double time of a IUI. Coming down to that point, the Cochrane in 2003 supports the double IUI insemination. But there is a 2017 report which will tell you by I think the group name is a Van et al. In 2017. They clearly indicate that the single time IUI is much more or same effective as that of the two times or double insemination IUI. Okay, Amit, there was a question. Yes. Okay, you given a HCG trigger and follicle doesn't rupture, what you will do? See, there is a beautiful thing. If some of you are much more doing IVF also, I need not to say, if you give the trigger and after 24 hours you do a urinary pregnancy test and it shows two lines in it, it means that it is already your trigger is good. Or some of the IVF lab, they do a follicular fluid pregnancy test. So if you are doing a trigger is right and if it is not ruptured, you never know what is the science of rupture. Then let me go into the details of the science of rupture. What is the science of rupture? Is there is a collapsed follicle. All of us knowing that it is collapsing follicle, it means that it is ruptured. If it is not collapsed and you see a free fluid in the pouch of Douglas, it means it is collapsed. Or if you have a color Doppler in your OPD, you just do the color Doppler and you see RI and PI values. If it is RI is less than 0.5, it means it is already been ruptured because it's a less resistive. And at the time of LH peak, you have high resistive flow of that follicle. So unruptured follicle is only a limited entity, and that to be limited to the 10% of the population of infertility. So if you are sure in your trigger, you should not be worried about doing the IUI then and there after 24 hours or before 40 hours of your things are. And there will be another question by who? Abha, yeah. What do you call as a double trigger? In IUI cycles, we never thought of doing a double trigger or something like that, rescuing trigger. That all things is preserved for IVF. That I will be talking about the trigger, which is the best trigger and what is the trigger in a year, in a months to come. So today only we are talking about the IUI and its broader aspects of doing IUI. So up till now we talked about the indications, we talked about the male factor, we talked about semen preparation, what is my minimal count that has to be there, post wash count. When I'm talking about the count, mind well, for all my friends in the world, it is a total modal count. So I'm not talking about just a count. So we talked about the count, we talked about Now we will be talking about something. Okay, Priti Vaha is asking, yeah. In the first cycle, the patient develops the follicle, but in the next time, in the same dose of the letrozole, no follicle was developed. What was the cause? Priti, this is an excellent finding, what you are observed. And many of time, all of us are observed the same, but none of us talked in a conferences, in a whatever forum we talked about. It is a beautiful thing when all of you are doing IVF cycles, you started with the same dose. Suppose 150 international units of recombinant FSH, for that matter, clofenacetate. Some of them respond and some of them doesn't respond. That is because of the FSH receptor polymorphism. If you know this term very well, it is called as a FSH receptor polymorphism. Certain receptors are acting on certain receptors are much more responsiveness to the FSH, and certain receptors are not showing the response in that particular cycle. So the receptor polymorphism is documented, and that's why you get the response in a particular patient. In particular patients, you doesn't get a response at all with the same dose or same drug. You even if not change the batch for that matter, not change the manufacturing, still you will not get the response. So it holds true when you are talking about the FSH polymorphism, and that's why you, even if you do a IVF, you do all the things, you see the responsiveness, you see all these things, and you not retrieve the oocytes. So this is called as a responsiveness or FSH receptor polymorphism. So coming down to the another things of my talk, I'll be going into the details of stimulation protocol will be a different topic altogether. So we finished with the double or maybe a single time IUI. Now all the things are prepared, the catheter is come down to you. You are planning to do IUI. What you will advise to the patient: full bladder, empty bladder, half filled bladder, and any USG guidance. There are a lot of things which is going on. In India, there is permutations and nothing to talk about. What is the standard practice guidelines? The standard practice, when the catheter with the pre, what you called as a semen prepared sample is coming down to you, and you wish to do a IUI, you need to do there is called as a volume, which is important thing. The most of the all of us are knowing the what is the volume, uterine volume. The uterine volume is 0.5, 0.3 to 0.5. So any volume which is more than that will be called as a tubal flushing. So you are flushing the tubes with the semen sample, which is not advocated. What we want is we want a good sample or good motile sperms to be into the uterine cavity. We don't want it to be going to the fallopian tube. So the sample volume should be less than 0.5. It should be actively motile sperm without any leukocytes, because if the sample which has been prepared having the leukocyte or for that matter pus cells, which will the patient usually tell you the cramps after the IUI. It is nothing to do with your procedure. It is dealing with you a prepared, how you prepared the semen sample. If the semen sample is not been prepared and it has the leukocytes, and then the IUI procedures will be causing the cramps, post procedure cramps. And then there is another question which come up, the bleeding after the IUI. If there is a bleeding after you done the procedures, or you done the procedure and you've seen the semen sample, which is called as semen reflux. The semen reflux is usually because of you, because much more is the first is the semen sample is not been properly been done, because if it contains the leukocyte, it will liberate the prostaglandins. The prostaglandins usually causes the contractions of the uterus, and that causes the semen samples to reflux in. Secondly, if you are going to inject the more sample into the uterine cavity, automatically there is a reflux back. There is no need to do panicky about it, because it's going to happen, it happened. It means you are something is not good regarding the preparation of the semen sample, or maybe the volume is on a higher side. Secondly, if there is a bleeding, when you've done the IUI and is there is a bleeding, or you are not negotiating the catheter and somehow you negotiate and somehow you've done the procedure and it is bleeding occurred. Mind well, friends, when we are doing the IUI, IUI is the semen which is deposited into the uterine cavity. After that, there is a decapacitation or maybe a capacitated, or the actually motile sperm is going to get migrated into the fallopian tube. All of us are knowing the oocyte and the sperm going to get that is called as fertilization, and then there is implantation. The implantation takes place 3 to 4 days after this all the fertilization is going to get occur. So even if there is a bleeding, definitely there is evidence that decreases the IUI success rate because you have not done the procedure properly. But mind well, you should not be panicky enough, which will tell you that there is decrease in the pregnancy rates when there is a bleeding on the catheter. There was a question about any particular standard duration to push the semen sample. And the second question is, what is the drug of choice for luteal cells? I will come down to the luteal phase support, yes, in a while. And okay, so role of progesterone after the IUI. Rupesh, I'll be talking to that about the progesterone and the support in a while, because now I think we are on Facebook Live maybe a half an hour or more. I'm just talking to all of you. So these are the certain precautions has to be done. The first is a way that you must negotiate the cervix without any bleeding. Even if there is a bleeding, you should not be panic. The 0.3 to 0.5 is the volume has to be injected into the uterine cavity. It should be slow. There won't be a particular procedure, how much is the timing and how much is the flow or how much time you should do the flushing of the catheter. Definitely there is a nowadays we don't do a proper cleaning or called a cervical mucus aspiration, because mind well, when we are doing the IUI, we are bypassing the cervix. So there is no role of what you call as cleaning of the cervical mucus or the vaginal part. That is only been advocated in an embryo transfer. I'll be taking a different talk of an embryo transfer and difficult embryo transfer in a months together. So when you are talking about the IUI procedure, IUI is just you have to give a lithotomy position. I'll be giving you a live Facebook, not now because we are in a corona phase and all of us are not doing any elective procedure. So the live procedure will be demonstrated in a months or maybe in 2 months time. But till then, I'll just explain you what actually we do in all my centers. We just ask the patient to void the urine, give a proper lithotomy position, expose the cervix by the Cusco speculum, and then if you wish to do, if there is so much of vaginal secretions or too much of excessive cervical secretions, then definitely you clean the part and then do the procedures. IUI with the sonography guidance is not a routine practice. One should not be routinely doing it because it's a OPD procedure, and under sonography guidance, one should not be thinking of that is the ideal way of doing the IUI. Then coming down to the part which is all of us are worried about is how much is the karyotype, role of karyotype. Yes, Begum, yeah, I'll be talking about it in a while. Definitely there is a role of karyotyping. I'll be coming down to that also, or just now I will finish it up. As rightly you talked about is a karyotype, role of karyotyping in severe cases. I'm talking about severe cases. If there is a severe oligoasthenoteratozoospermia, definitely you should be doing a karyotyping, and that to be a micro deletion of a Y chromosome. Micro deletion, and that has to be talked about, because when you are doing IUI, and for that matter, if you are knowing there is something called as a genetic problem or Y chromosome micro deletion of a Y chromosome, definitely there is a higher chance that the offspring will have this particular problem in later on. So definitely, if there is a severe oligoasthenoteratozoospermia, you must you must do detailed karyotyping, and that to be specifically talking about microdeletion. So that is the one thing I was not talked about. So we coming down to the, after the IUI procedure has been done, and some of you advised the patient to be lying down or maybe a supine position for 10 to 15 minutes, whether it is advocated, whether it is not advocated. If you go to the literature and review of literature by ASRM, by ISHRAE, all of those are my friends overseas, all of us are not recommended the supine position bed rest for 10 to 15 minutes. It is not advocated after the IUI. IUI is a OPD procedure. One should not be advocated bed rest or maybe a supine position for 10 to 15 minutes. It's only been documented when you have a natural coitus. See, in a natural coitus, there is a semen which is deposited into the vagina. So vagina, sometimes what happens, the patient go not have the bed rest, or for that matter 15 minutes, it comes out, and that's why we not have a sufficient pull at the cervical part of a vaginal end. So in that particular case, you need to have talk to the patient. If it is a normal coitus activity, at least a supine position should be advocated. Or if it is not ruptured, if you given a trigger, yeah. Shobha, I think, can you hear me properly now? There is some network issue. Can anyone tell me whether I am audible? I am audible? Now I am audible? Okay, thank you Shobha, thanks. So I was talking about the bed rest and supine position rest. There is no need. There was a question from the Begum, I was like, whether the follicle is ruptured, whether you still go for IUI. The patient is posted for IUI, Begum, so there is no point in talking whether the follicle is ruptured or not ruptured. If it is a stimulated cycle, whether you are giving a trigger, you need to do IUI between 24 to 40 hours of your trigger. Yes, then the Girija is asking, how do you go about difficult negotiation of the catheters? Difficult negotiation, what do you mean by the difficult negotiation? Is a retroverted uterus, that may be the first thing, or maybe acutely antiverted uterus. You anticipated when you are doing the scan. If you done the scan by yourself, you are the person who will know whether it is acutely retroverted or it is acutely antiverted. If it is acutely antiverted, semi-filled bladder is the key. You ask the patient to drink water, and if it is semi-filled bladder, that acutely antiverted uterus get angulated, and it is very easy to negotiate the cervix. If it is still what you call as not negotiated, you can use a different catheters. There is called as a semi-flexible and a rigid catheter. You can use a rigid catheter. I think I am audible. Yeah, some of them are not replying, not audible. I am audible to all of you, so I can talk. Anyone can reply. Yeah. Yes, Girija. Thank you, Girija, for that particular thing. Yes. So if you are thinking of not negotiating the catheter, it is better to change the catheter. You can use a rigid catheter. You can use even if embryo transfer catheter, outer sheath of the embryo transfer catheter, if it is a too much of difficult IUI. And thank you Vikram, thanks. Thank you Girija. Yeah, so the difficult IUI can be tackled with use of semi-filled bladder or maybe a rigid catheter. You can use embryo transfer catheter outer sheath, or if it is a retroverted uterus, then I know you should not be using a tinaculum or something like that. But if you apply the tinaculum on the posterior lip of the cervix and just give a gentle, see, the gentleness can be different for different person. For me, a gentle is a word to remember when you are doing a IUI. because the gentle traction on the posterior lip, which will gives you a correction of the angle, and you can negotiate through it. Yes, Chetan, good question. There is advice to intercourse pre or post IU. Definitely, nowadays all of us are advocated, even if after the post embryo transfer you can have a sexual activity or the coitus. Same hold true when you are doing a IUI. You can advise the patient for a after procedure coital activity, because all of us are knowing the coital activities has a different role to play. It has a role to play when, as far as the endorphin is taken into account, as far as your see, there is not the pregnancy. If it is like that, endorphin or what you call as the inner hormones is not going to get play the role. All of us are doing IVF, not having 100% result. So the coital activity is not only to have the coital activity. It has the plays role at your inner aspects of the body mechanism, your hormonal aspects of it. Then your endorphin levels will be, your mood levels, your anxiety levels drops down, your acceptance to the treatment. That is much more thing which is not been documented anywhere. I was going through the literature, I came to know, even if you advise the patient for normal coital activity post procedure, that will reduce down the post procedure tension. So chances of increase in the pregnancy rates are there, and that has been documented. So definitely we will be encouraging patient of the post coital activity for the procedure. Hi Paula, hi. And now we'll be talking about how many cycles, stimulated, non-stimulated, natural cycle IUI, and whether the cycle is should be repeated 6 times, 9 times, 12 times, something like that. So when there is a ISHRAE strong evidence, like if you are doing a stimulated cycles IUI, is a 3 cycles, not more than that. If you are doing a IUI cycles, can you do HCG and IUI in the same cycle? Vishal, when you are doing a HCG usually is done in a prior to the 10th day of a menstruation. So the follicular phase is variable. So you need to understand, if you have stimulated the patient and she is a follicle is ready by 9th day, and you have done the HCG maybe at 7 days prior, there is always a risk of exposure. So it is better to do a one procedure at one time rather than combining the HCG and the IUI in the same cycle period. So coming down to the number of cycles. So the number of cycles is limited to the 3 when you're talking about stimulated cycles, and when you're talking about unexplained infertility and IUI, it is limited to the 6. But if someone asks me why 3 and why not 4 and why not 5? See, there are the beautiful study which will quote, if you started the patient on IUI cycles, the success rate is 7 to 8% in the first three cycles. I repeat my words, if you are doing the IUI and you wish to have the success rate, I am talking about pregnancy rates, it is better to document it that it is higher in first 3 months, and then after that it remains steady, or if it is decline. So if you are declining, the things are, it is not the procedure which is worthwhile of doing it. So if you are doing the procedure for 3 months or 3 consecutive months, the success rate increases. Cumulative pregnancy rate is 20 to 30% if you are doing a stimulated IUI cycles for 3 months. Yeah, for a progesterone support, and I will be talking in a while, but it will take me a longer time to talk about every drug in every manner. So today only I will be talking about IUI. I will not touching the points about follicle stimulation protocols. I will not talk about luteal phase support. I will not talk about trigger, what particular cycle or what particular follicle I will be giving a trigger. I will be just talking about IUI, the procedure, semen parameters, male factor infertility I already talked about. So similarly, I will be talking about number of cycles. So if you are talking of number of cycles of IUI, it has to deliver the results, has to be delivered in 3 months. After the 3 months, there is no doing these procedures again and again. I think my overseas friends will agree what I am talking about. Secondly, the pregnancy rates dropped after 2 cycles. So if you are doing the IUI cycles again and again, it reduces your pregnancy rates. Thank you Shobha, thanks. Yeah, so repeated cycles has no point in doing the procedures again and again. So the coming down to our again consent, yes Rupesh, I will be talking about the consent. First let me talk about the steps to improvise the success rate, because and then I will be only 2 points I'll be talking about. First is the improvisation of the success rate when you are doing the IUI cycles. Because see, IUI cycles, I am also doing, the friends of mine in Jordan, he or she is also doing, you people are also doing in India. Why it makes a difference to different center? First is the selection of the patient. Younger the age group, better is the success rate. Semen parameters. If your total motile count, sperm count is more than 10 million post-wash, giving up better results. What the previous protocols has been used. If you are used clomiphene citrate, single follicle development or multifollicle development IUI. If it is single follicle development IUI with the letrozole, what is the support is been given or not. If it is at all been given, why she is not conceived. You need to categorize that particular patient. I talked to you about the trial that is called as if you all of you are those who are interested, those can really go into the depth of it. We know, all of us are knowing now, it is like a calculator how much dose of gonadotropins to be given. So if the someone is coming down to me with the clomiphene citrate cycles been received and IUI has been given, the IUI treatment protocol has been given, I will not been doing the same thing again and again. I'll be switching over to the gonadotropin stimulation and the IUI. And then there is a beautiful calculator which is available, which will tell you about the BMI. You have to just go and get it done. You have to know AFC, you have to know what is the AMH of the patient, and just enter the data. You will know what is the dose of the gonadotropins which is required. Because if I wanted to select the patient, if the BMI is more than 25 or for that matter 30, the chances of gonadotropins requirement is increased. They will require increased dose of a gonadotropins. She will not have the good response with the 75 international units. She may require higher amount of gonadotropin. Similarly, if she is having the low BMI, she will respond beautifully with the oral ovulations or maybe a gonadotropins with the lesser dose. Similarly, young age will respond better, AMH will be a higher, her AFC will be higher, so they will have the better pregnancy rate. Similarly with the male factors, if the male age is a lesser, IUI success rate is much more higher. If the total motile count is more than 10 million post wash, gives me more pregnancy rates. Then there is called as a fast trial. Fast trial is been documented when this particular NICE guidelines comes in 2013. They done a fast trial. The fast trial usually quotes about the cost effectiveness, because in UK, I suppose all of the things are taken care by the government policies, but rest of the world, the patient has to pay from the pocket. So when you are talking about the cost effectiveness for the IUI, and that's why the NICE guidelines, they showed that it is experimental and IUI should not be done. All of the patient, even if they really wanted to go for the ART treatment, IVF is the better chance. It's not hold true. If you are really wanted to go into the cost effectiveness, go for the trial called as a fast trial, which is been telling you about the number of gonadotropins required, number of expenditures, number of NICU's admissions, number of multifetal pregnancies, and what is the take home baby rate. So 5 parameters if you consider, and that has been considered in a trial which was documented by that is called as a pro ProRails trial. In a ProRails trial, they documented number of gonadotropins required. They documented number of attempts of IUI cycles to have the babies. Then they documented IVF pregnancies, like a single selective embryo transfers, single blast transfers. And they compare modified natural IVF cycles. And they compare six cycles of IUI. They come up with the frank opinion, that is called as a robust opinion, about all these things, about the cost effectiveness. The still today, if there is a patient of unexplained infertility comes down to you, you ask the patient to wait for 1 year, ask them to have a natural coital activities to achieve the pregnancies. If they are not achieving the pregnancies of unexplained infertility, where I mean that the count of the male, for that matter, a total motile count is more than 10, you can advise them. Still today, there is a role of IUI and ovulation stimulation protocols, and IUI is the first line of a treatment. Those patients who are having a mild factor infertility, male infertility, like the semen parameters less than 10 million total motile count, then still there is a hope in doing the IUI at least for 3 cycles, and then if that particular fails, you have definitely not audible. Okay. Nitin, I think I can talk for half an hour. Talking like this may be a little bit not comfortable with my audio system though. Now I am audible. Anyone can reply me, yeah. So many people watching. Nitin is replied me not audible, so that's why. Am I audible? Okay, yeah. So there is a one query that even after 8 days of a stimulation in PCOS with letrozole, no follicle response. Can we start the clomiphene citrate in the same cycle without getting a withdrawal bleeding? Chetan, yeah. So addressing to this particular question, she is a case of a polycystic ovaries, and you are given a letrozole. See, the letrozole already been given to this patient and she's not showing any follicular response. That means that the particular drug is not acting on, and all of us are knowing, then you can definitely go, even if you wanted not want to let this cycle go. So you can start giving this particular patient gonadotropins instead of again going to the clomiphene citrate. No, clomiphene citrate will not be effective once you're given a letrozole. So once you're given a letrozole, it is better to give a gonadotropin to those patients. So coming down to a cost effectiveness of this particular thing, what is the cost effectiveness for the six cycles, modified natural IVF and a single blast transfer. So this particular trial, which clearly indicates that a ProRails trial from Netherlands, anyone can correct me, this is the trial which is really given us a good guidelines about the IUI still has a role, and this has been done in a ISRE in the Netherlands group from Netherlands. So they definitely come down to the conclusion that the IUI has a still place when you are talking about unexplained infertility, or for that matter mild male factor infertility. So IUI can be taken into account, maybe a 3 cycles of IUI. If the 3 cycles failed, then definitely you can go for IVF, or for that matter modified natural cycles IVF. So hope I'm done with this particular exercise of today's talking to all of you about IUIs, and what IUIs in which patients, selection of the patients, and which I have not talked about which protocol, and I have not talked about the luteal phase support, but there was 2-3 times the people was asking about the progesterone support. So let me talk to you only in 2 lines. Whenever there is a natural cycle IUI, no need of giving any luteal phase support, luteal phase support is not required for natural cycles IUI. Natural cycles IUI, you should not give, for that matter, any type of progesterone. No vaginal, no intramuscular, no oral progesterone is required. If you are talking about a stimulated ovarian stimulation cycle IUI, then a letrozole, or if you are giving a clomiphene citrate, no requirement of giving a luteal phase support with the progesterone. I hope I am very clear and loud. So if you are giving a natural cycle any support which is of no use, if you are giving a letrozole, or for that matter your clomiphene citrate, which has no meaning of giving a luteal phase support, if you are used a gonadotropin, if you are used a gonadotropin, definitely there is a role of giving a luteal phase support. Luteal phase support can be given in a oral form, can be given in a vaginal form, can be an injectable form. I will not talk in the details about anything, because that will be a next our talk of a discussion, which progesterone, how much period of time and which dose has to be given. Secondly, about there was a question about stimulation protocols. I'll be talking to you in maybe a day two, or maybe after 2 days, or maybe after 1 day or 24 hours about stimulation strategies, about stimulation protocols in IUI. And I think my colleague, she will be talking to you about a semen preparation in IUI. Will not going to have a live relay because of this corona epidemic, what you call as a pandemic now. We are not having the live relay of semen preparation, but she will be telling it to you about how we do a density gradient. She will draw a diagram for all of you. She will be explaining you a media, composition of the media. There was a question about the which media we used, commercial available, what is the things are. She will be talk to you about the details about a preparation of a semen sample for IUI, and for IVF it is different. So she will be taking talking to you all these things in details, maybe after 2 days. I think all of you can just send me a suggestion, which is the standard time where we can Facebook live should be, because there are the queries from the Turkey and I think from Morocco. They have talked about the timing problems, because for there it is a 9 o'clock in the morning, and I don't know what is the suitable time, because from the corona pandemic all of us are not working, as the planned procedures are not going to happen, only emergency OTs are there. So any particular time, you just WhatsApp me, or you can have this page to interact. We are talking about your semen preparations in a 24 hours time. So please let me know, and any queries regarding this talk, about from the history of IUI till date, whether we are validating in doing the IUI, I am very much sure that this particular talk is much more informative, because live relay of my operatives will not be there for a week, or maybe 2 weeks, or maybe 3 weeks, depending upon lockdown period. Maybe after that I'll be doing a live relay of my patients, or maybe a surgeries, what we are posting it here. Till that time, I think this is the good media where I can interact with my friends across the globe, and hope this is much more interactive. If you are putting the patient like queries, your points of interaction to me. Thank you for being live.